the journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Good afternoon, I'm Denise Sensai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. An ally of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio says she will run for president in next year's elections. The Kusi wing of the ruling party PDP Laban denies preparing for the substitution of the president's daughter for a national post. And Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez says the Philippines is determined to be a world leader in the fight against climate change. A close ally of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio claims she will run for president. Albay Representative Joey Salceda says he spoke to Duterte Carpio on Tuesday, moments before she withdrew her re-election bid. Her decision to back down from the mayoralty race further fueled speculations she will gun for a national post in the 2022 elections.
She's running for president. All this political gyration just shows that she's moving towards the presidency. There is no VP option for her. And picking a VP for her is not a problem. Based on our long-running chats, kilometric chats, that she eyes her. Because I provided her with so many data analytics, big data, and everything about her prospects, and I think she would make a good president.
Duterte Carpio repeatedly said in the past she will not seek the presidency. Asked what changed her mind, Salceda has this to say.
She wanted to be president in the first place. She wanted to run actually since May. So wala naman nagbago sa kanya talaga. There were just stumbling blocks towards it. Eh. So in order to clear it, hindi naman niya pwedeng diktahan yung tatay niya. So she had her way of clearing these roadblocks. Sabi kasi niya, she's no last minute candidate. Eh. Sabi ko nga, baka you might be violating what you said earlier. Mm-mm. So indefinitely, hindi yan mandate.
2022 vice presidential aspirant Senator Bongo also hinting at a change of plan. Go, who is running under the ruling party PDP Laban, gave an emotional speech about the future of his candidacy on Tuesday. The same day, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio dropped her mayoral bid.
Kandidatura ko bilang vice presidente ay maaring magbago. Ang problema about the substitution dito sa politika, maaring may magbabago sa mga tatakbuhang posisyon sa mga darating na araw. Ang problema po dyan, kailangan ko umiwas. Gustuhin ko mang magsilbi sa inyo bilang inyong vice presidente dahil sa kagustuhan ng ating mahal na Pangulo. Kailangan ko pong umiwas. Malalaman nyo lang po yan sa darating na araw.
Go, a longtime aide of President Rodrigo Duterte, also talked about the chief executive's possible senatorial run.
As a senator candidate, 51% running, 49% not running. So yan po ang aking personal assessment kung tatakbo si Pangulong Duterte.
The PDP Laban faction, led by Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi, refutes claims it is already preparing to substitute Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio for a national post. Cusi says the party is also monitoring the next step of the president's daughter. But he admits Duterte Carpio's possible bid for a national post will affect the political landscape. The PDP Laban Cusi wing currently has Senator Ronald De La Rosa and Senator Bongo as its presidential and vice presidential bets. Some analysts believe all these political moves point to a possible Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Sara Duterte Carpio tandem in 2022. They believe the recent events and statements from Duterte's allies indicate the president's daughter will not be gunning for the country's top post.
Ang basa ko is as VP, I think. Kasi meron din developments na mga nakaraan. No? Yung sinabi ni Marcos Jr. noong mga nakaraang araw, he said na si Sara Duterte hindi natatakbo bilang presidente. But he did not really say whether Sara Duterte is going to run as vice president. Pangalawa, yung pag-withdraw po ni Mayor Sara, kakibat naman yon yung statement ni Senator Bongo, no? Na nagpapahiwatig na hindi, wala nang kasiguraduhan yung pagtakbo niya sa VP.
Even if you have the political capital and the wherewithal to run a strong campaign for the presidency, it is best to slide to the vice presidency and perhaps bide your time until you are strong enough. The best logical combination for both of them, because first and foremost, they've already had an informal alliance. The Dutertes and the Marcoses have had an informal alliance in 2016. And now is the time for them to formalize that alliance since their politics are essentially the same. No? They both constitute what can be considered an anti-EDSA coalition.
As for the opposition, Professor Julio Tehanki says they must now go back to the drawing board to prepare for a possible Marcos Duterte tandem.
Unfortunately, for the opposition, they are still caught in what is known as the prisoner's dilemma, that they believe that on their own they can win, no? And the more they pursue their political self-interest, the more their votes will be divided, and the more they will not be able to combine their strength to mount a formidable challenge to the administration. And it's so easy to win if you have, all these votes scattered all over the place. No? So consolidation is key.
A veteran campaign strategist doubts Mayor Duterte Carpio will settle for the vice presidency. According to Alan German, tactically, Duterte Carpio running for vice president does not make sense since her campaign would rely on the continuity narrative. He adds the Duterte camp's latest gimmick just goes to show Filipino voters still love election drama.
Will the drama still hold out? Based on sentiment analysis, and we do this as a practice, we do quick sentiment analysis or QSS readings, it seems to have tickled and reignited the fire of their supporters. So yeah, that seems to be that seems to have worked. Ultimately, the polls will decide that. We shall see in May. Now, to your point, very, very interesting. What is she saving? What is she changing, so to speak? It's no longer a change is coming. I think the play now is continuity plus. The way I'm reading it, it does not make any sense tactically and politically for Mayor Inday to run at this point for anything but president. If the goal is continuity plus, she won't be able to achieve that as vice president. And personality-wise, if you look at the Duterte family, they're all about control and being at the helm and running things their way, almost my way or the highway. So I don't think she would play second fiddle to anyone.
The spokesperson of the Philippine Commission on Elections in favor of regulating the candidate substitution rule. Director James Jimenez says they have seen more instances of candidates withdrawing from the race just to be replaced by another contender. While the move is legal, Jimenez points out, the law does not clearly specify the grounds for withdrawal.
Yan yung sinasabi ng maraming kababayan natin ngayon na dapat meron lang mga legitimate or allowed reasons. Wala pong ganun under the law, which means lahat pinapayagan. Siguro tama nga na tignan kung baka pwedeng maglagay ng konting regulasyon para hindi lang walang dahilan. No, kasi ngayon ang nangyayari, at whim, that sort of runs counter to orderly elections.
President Rodrigo Duterte urges the Commission on Elections to designate a place where candidates can hold in-person campaigns. Duterte notes some contenders cannot afford the expense of TV exposures to reach voters.
I'd like to remind the COMELEC that you must give the candidates really the space and the whatever modality is there. Because there can never be an election without a campaign. Other people cannot also afford, some candidates cannot afford the expense of the TV exposures. You have to have a place where maybe they would limit the attendance or the number of people there.
The poll body has said it's not inclined to ban face-to-face campaigns despite the pandemic. It is expected to release a list of guidelines to ensure sorties would not become super spreader events. In other news, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio fires her information officer for attending a party where authorities seized illegal drugs. Jeffrey Tupas admitted she was at the event held at a resort in Davao de Oro, but she claims she left the party early. Anti-drug officers who raided the resort arrested 17 people and confiscated some 1.5 million pesos worth of party drugs and marijuana. The Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency says they will investigate claims that agents raiding the party allowed Tupas and others to leave.
From the very start of the operation, 17 na po yung ating arrested drug personality. So, hindi natin alam how come nagkaroon ng ganyan. But of course, yun nga, as I've said earlier, there is a beach park, a lot of people there. Kasi yung sinasabi na whatever it is that they are saying, these are mere speculations they're making.
Duterte Carpio, whose father has waged a massive war against illegal drugs, has been distancing herself from this issue. The Philippine Health Department recommends the voluntary use of face shields in areas under Alert Level 1. Health Secretary Francisco Duque says this policy can also be implemented in areas under Alert Level 2, except when inside public transportation. Duque's statement comes after some mayors went ahead and scrapped the face shield mandate in their respective cities without the consent of the national government.
Ipadadaanin muna sa IATF bago po namin sumite for your approval, Mr. President. So sa Thursday po, magkakaroon ng pagpupulong ang IATF.
President Duterte says there is nothing illegal about companies refusing to hire job applicants who are not inoculated against COVID-19. For him, what's illegal is to fire unvaccinated workers. He says turning down unvaccinated job seekers is just a way for employers to protect their businesses.
Kung nandiyan ka na sa trabaho mo at ayaw mong magpabakuna, well, that is too bad for the employer. The other problem is yung papasok kayo na you seek employment, and then one of the reasons that would be asked of you by the prospective employer would be kung bakunado ka. Na kung sabihin mo hindi, at whatever reason ibigay mo doon sa kanya, para ang importante lang naman sa kanya, bakunado ka hindi. Kung hindi ka bakunado, hindi ka tanggapin sa trabaho. I think that is legal. You have the right to refuse to accept as an employee of somebody who is not vaccinated.
The Philippines determined to be a world leader in the fight against climate change. Speaking at the COP26 summit in Glasgow, Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez reiterated Manila's commitment to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 75% by 2030. He said this is the boldest goal yet put forward by any country.
We just launched the Sustainable Finance Roadmap to deploy engines of finance to get green projects moving across our archipelago. We are pushing for a law banning single-use plastics. We launched a partnership with the Asian Development Bank for a landmark project that will accelerate our transition from coal to clean energy. We have very high expectations for COP26 to become not just merely an annual platform for discussion, but a catalyst for concrete action plans. It is time to do some actual work on the ground and build a framework for climate justice.
The European Union pledges 100 million euros to the UN Adaptation Fund. The fund offers financing to developing countries which are vulnerable to the impact of climate change. The European Commission says the additional contribution from the bloc's budget is by far the biggest pledge made by donors at the UN Climate Conference in Glasgow. Adaptation finance is one of the central topics of discussion at COP26 and is the high priority for the EU.
Today is the day we need to act on adaptation as well. Financing adaptation is critical. We all repeated that mantra endlessly, but the rhetoric, sadly, is not followed by action. We all need to get cracking, and we all need to do it now. Because those who need resources for adaptation also need to have predictability and clarity about its delivery. To the parties pushing for more ambition, I say this: you will find the EU on your side. To the parties stopping and stalling progress, I say, What are you waiting for? Science tells us we're out of time.
The COP26 summit centers on limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. Now, this report explains just how significant that number is.
1.5 within reach.
So to keep that 1.5 goal in sight,
a 1.5 degree budget.
Vital 1.5 degrees climate target.
Above 1.5.
World leaders and scientists have stressed that 1.5 degrees Celsius is the magic number when it comes to saving our planet. The 2015 Paris Agreement commits countries to limit the global average temperature rise to below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, but they're aiming for 1.5. So, what difference does 0.5 of a degree actually make? The world has already heated to around 1.1 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. Scientists say crossing the 1.5 degrees Celsius threshold risks unleashing far more severe climate change effects on people, wildlife, and ecosystems. Just this year, torrential rains flooded China and Western Europe. The Pacific Northwest sweltered in record heat, and Greenland saw massive melting events. Climate scientist Daniela Jacob at the Climate Service Centre Germany says, quote, half a degree means much more extreme weather, and it can be more often, more intense, or extended in duration. The difference between 1.5 degrees C and 2 degrees C is also critical for Earth's oceans and frozen regions. Warming of 1.5 degrees would destroy at least 70% of coral reefs. But at 2 degrees, more than 99% would be lost. Take Australia's Great Barrier Reef, for example. A recent study has found that the corals could still have a chance to survive if global warming is kept to 1.5 degrees. Professor Terry Hughes of the Australian Research Council's Centre of Excellence for Coral Reef Studies is the study's lead author.
Trajectory of the Great Barrier Reef will depend critically on how much hotter the planet gets. If we can hold global warming to 1.5 degrees global average warming, then I think we'll still have a vibrant Great Barrier Reef. But if we go to 3-4 degrees of global average warming, which is tragically the trajectory we're currently on, then there won't be much left of the Great Barrier Reef or any other coral reefs throughout the tropics.
Avoiding crossing the 1.5 degree threshold requires almost halving global CO2 emissions by 2030 from 2010 levels and cutting them to net zero by 2050. It's an ambitious task that scientists, financiers, negotiators and activists continue to debate how to achieve and pay for.
We should try and keep 1.5 within reach, and I hope that is the spirit with which negotiators will continue to approach these discussions.
We're taking a quick break. Coming up, local air carriers are planning to increase flights as COVID-19 restrictions across the Philippines ease. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC's Rundown.
Charm Fabric Conditioner with Stay Fresh Technology. Damitay ka blooms!
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
for the first time in 7 days. The MIT index back below the 7,400 level after shedding nearly 0.9%. Sun Life Asset Management says the local bourse succumbed to profit-taking following a sell-off on Wall Street overnight. Other Asia markets are also trading lower, with markets in China and Hong Kong leading the decline. Local air carriers plan to add more flights as several areas in the Philippines shift to COVID-19 alert level 2. The Air Carriers Association of the Philippines is still mainly banking on domestic tourists to tide them through the remainder of this year. But the group hopes government can further relax restrictions on international travel soon.
Losses for the local carriers this year will definitely be larger than last year's industry losses. In 2020, you had the first quarter was still pretty normal. So so that left some, you know, some numbers, traffic numbers in favor of the carriers. But this year, we were starting from zero, really, right?
Yeah.
Zero in the sense that we were already on full COVID scenario. We're really hoping that the efforts of government to relax international travel, particularly for Filipinos, because foreign tourists as a rule are not yet allowed in the Philippines. But we are targeting the balikbayans, for example, of North America.
Members of the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, or APEC, agreed to boost the region's recovery by maintaining free trade. Foreign and trade ministers from the 21-nation APEC met online Wednesday to discuss their COVID-19 response ahead of a meeting of national leaders on Saturday. The host, New Zealand Trade Minister Damien O'Connor, said one of the highlights was the group's commitment to liberalize tariffs on vaccines and other pandemic medical supplies.
In this meeting, ministers reiterated APEC's strong stance against vaccine nationalism. We all know that none of us are safe until we are all safe. It was heartening to hear that no APEC economy has introduced vaccine export restrictions since we discussed a shared response to vaccine nationalism back in June.
The ministers also talked about freezing fossil fuel subsidies to help manage climate change. The U.S. may have reopened its borders to visitors this week, but vaccinated asylum seekers are still met with closed doors. The details in this report.
The U.S. this week finally lifted pandemic-era restrictions on non-essential travel, meaning vaccinated visitors can again enter the country. But extraordinary COVID-19 limits levied on desperate asylum seekers clustered along the U.S.-Mexico border are still in place. They cannot enter to apply for asylum, whether they're vaccinated or not. That has rights groups outraged at a policy they say is hypocritical and dangerous. Leo fled his hometown in southern Mexico with his wife and two children after his uncle was murdered by gang members and he received death threats. His goal was to reach the U.S. and claim asylum. But after months of waiting, he's seen no sign he'll be able to apply for asylum soon, even after similar barriers lifted for others.
Just a few minutes ago, my family and I went to the border to ask for asylum, but unfortunately, the agents told us they're not taking asylum cases. How is it possible that people who are just going for tourism can be allowed in? We also have our COVID tests and we've been vaccinated. How can they do this to us? We are in danger by being here.
The Biden administration has kept in place an order called Title 42, a health measure created by former President Donald Trump barring asylum seekers from entering the U.S. to prevent the spread of COVID-19. The Biden administration has said Title 42 remains necessary to curb coronavirus transmission in crowded claim processing centers at the border. The idea that a vaccinated asylum seeker is more of a risk than a vaccinated tourist is laughable, said Noah Gottschalk with Oxfam America.
So it's a huge hypocrisy, right? Because they are now letting in not only essential travel, but also non-essential travel who's vaccinated. But we have asylum seekers here who are vaccinated, and they're not permitted to enter because of a COVID risk, essentially, is the whole justification for it. If it doesn't make sense, it's because it doesn't.
Leo has been working in construction to pay for rent in Nogales, but he says his earnings are not enough to support his family. He is also worried about his children getting hit by a stray bullet when gunshots ring out at night. The U.S. State Department recommends Americans reconsider travel to the Mexican state of Sonora, where Nogales is located, due to crime and kidnapping.
The lyric video of this year's ABS-CBN Christmas ID hits 1 million views on YouTube less than 24 hours after its release. As of writing, Andito Tayo Para Sa Isa't Isa raked 1.8 million views on YouTube and over 6 million views on Facebook. The all-star recording of the song includes Sharon Cuneta, Regine Velasco, Sara Geronimo, among others. Celebrity love team Catherine Bernardo and Daniel Padilla, as well as other young personalities, also lent their voices. ABS-CBN says the tune is a loving tribute to everyday heroes who continuously give hope, strength, and inspiration despite these trying times. Now, before we go, ABS-CBN is calling for donations for Pantawid ng Pag-ibig campaign, where every 100 peso donation can feed a family in need during this COVID-19 pandemic. There are now more convenient ways to donate through our digital payment partners, Lazada and Shopee. Kindly prepare your mobile phone to donate via GCash. Just scan a QR code as seen on the screen. You can also donate through PayMaya and Cebuana Luillier. And finally, the following peso and dollar accounts remain open to receive donations. Let us all contribute what we can. Together, our help can feed more Filipino families in need. Thank you for your generosity, Kapamilya. And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Tinsay. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. More news comes your way at 3. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation.